So we're going to talk about an iron in the sea of ultra-cold atoms. And so the picture that you see here kind of symbolizes what I want to talk about. This is here, the red dot is the iron. And then, you know, you think of the cold cloud of atoms as some kind of a liquid. And here, this is, of course, so it comes, goes out and in, as some kind of a liquid. And the iron interacts with that liquid. This is, of course, a picture of a water and a droplet, yeah? But this is kind of the picture, perhaps, that I have in mind. Now, the system, I think, is an interesting system to do open quantum, you know, to study open quantum phenomena. And, yeah, I'll get to that. Now, before I get into the talk, perhaps some details about where the city of Ulm is located and, you know, what is special about it. So it's the birthplace of Albert Einstein, for those who don't know. It has a medieval part of town. This is the Danube here. So, you know, one's the longest river in Europe, I think. Then here you have the church, the Münster in Ulm, which has the tallest steeple. And Ulm is, if this is Germany, it's kind of located a little bit in the south. And around Ulm, there's lots of caves, by the way, where they have found, you know, some of the oldest artifacts of mankind, like the oldest musical instrument and the oldest figurine, Venus figurine, and so on. So, and then not so far, a little bit further south, there you find some castles. Yeah, this is the castle of our crazy King Ludwig about 150 years ago has been built. So, although I'm not going to talk too much about the experiments in my group, still want to introduce quickly the team who does experiments with ions and atoms. And this is the general, in general, the idea. Yeah, so it's about ions and atoms. It's a relatively young field that has developed, it's about 10 years old. You have an ion, typically it's held in a Paul trap. It's very schematic here. You see some trap electrodes. You can essentially trap any ion. In our case, we work with barium plus. We can also work with rubidium plus or with the molecular ions. And then this ion is then immersed into a cloud of ultra-cold atoms. In our case, this is rubidium 87. We can work with the BEC if we want, and these atoms are trapped in an optical dipole trap. It's just a focused laser beam. And it turns out the two traps are nicely compatible with each other. So the whole setup actually looks, in our case, looks kind of complicated. Yeah, we have to bring together these two kind of different species. So first we have this alcohol vacuum chamber here. On that side, we have our magneto-optical trap where we produce ultra-cold rubidium atoms. Then they get transported over to here magnetically. There we do evaporative cooling. Then we have a transport up into the ion chamber. In this ion chamber, we have a linear Paul trap here with a single ion in there, waiting for the cold atoms. And then we kind of overlap the two species and do our experiments. Now, it's a new field, relatively young field, and it has a growing community. There's a number of experimental groups right now already who have joined this motion, and Sadik Rangwala actually also has a group here in Bangalore. So what is special about the combination of ion and atom? It has a relatively long-range interaction. And so what happens is that the barium ion, of course, it produces an electrical field, and that electrical field polarizes the neutral rubidium atom. And this dipole in this inhomogeneous field gets then attracted towards the barium ion, and that gives rise to a 1 over r to the 4 potential. And this is, of course, much more long range than the 1 over r to the 6 van der Waals potential that we normally have between neutral atoms. Now, what this means is that typically we will have to deal with very large scattering lengths, so huge cross-sections, typically on the order of a factor 100 to 1,000 larger than what we know from neutral atoms. And on the other hand, it will be difficult, more difficult to reach this S-wave regime where, you know, particles collide. They only interact at the lowest partial wave, yeah? Partial wave zero. And that only happens in our case for barium and rubidium at really cold temperatures of about 100 nanokelvin. So it's more difficult to reach, but in principle, these are temperatures that we know we can reach with our cold atoms. So here now a couple of ideas, how you could, which kind of experiments you could carry out with ions in such a bath of cold atoms. So there's a list here, and I will quickly go through the list, and afterwards I will, you know, talk about the individual topics a little bit longer. So we have the polaron, yeah. So the ion is an impurity in this cold gas of atoms, and due to the interaction, there might be some few body bound states that form and that you can investigate. Then you can do transport experiments where you take the ion and have it move through the, or the charge actually of the ion, have it move through the cold cloud. You can use the ion also for sensing, and you can study decoherence and dissipation, yeah, of the, let's say you put the ion into some superposition state and you immerse it into this cold cloud of atoms, and you see how quickly the coherence of that superposition state goes away. You know, you can use this ion and couple it now, quantum mechanically entangle it with other quantum systems. And finally, I also want to mention, we're going to spend some time on this, there's some interesting kinetics going on between the ion and the atoms, and in the end, you get typically an ion energy distribution, which is not Maxwell-Boltzmann. So let's start out with the first topic, the polaron. So you take this ion and you put it into the cold cloud of atoms. Now there's an attraction, and so it will form, if you're cold enough, a cloud of atoms that are kind of like attached to the ion. Yeah. So you can think of it as some kind of dressing of the ion. Yeah. Actually, the whole particle that forms, the polaron, has a different mass. Yeah. And what is interesting about this is that you can get, or you should easily get into the strong coupling regime where the ion is interacting so strongly with the atoms that it kind of digs a hole and then is trapped in its own hole. Yeah. So beside, you know, changing the density distribution of the atomic cloud, it will also trap itself in the cloud. Now, there have been a number of proposals in different regimes. Yeah, this regime is, for example, by a group of Thomas Busch, where you go into the 1D regime, and so then the atoms are kind of lined up in a tongue scarce. You have the ion in the center, and as you can see here, this is the density here, distribution for the atoms, and kind of digs a hole here, and then you see this periodicity of this corrugation. Would be nice to observe this. And in a slightly different regime, people earlier even have predicted that this bound state, this few body bound state, could also be viewed as some kind of molecular ion, like a molecular bound state. So you have the ion here, and now there's atoms are, you know, bound to this ion in quantized shells, and it's a little bit like an atom, So here you have the nucleus, and here you have the electrons. But the difference is, of course, that the atoms are bosons now. So you can have many bosons in one shell. typical binding energies that they have calculated in this paper was on the order of microkelvin, and the size of this mesoscopic bound state is on the order of a micron. Yeah, so it's already pretty sizable, and it should have a lifetime which is already sizable to 100 milliseconds. So these things would be interesting to observe, of course, but in order to get to do these experiments, you have to have temperatures that are low enough so that these bound states actually can form. Yeah, the temperature has to be of the same order or lower than the bound state energy, which is on the order of, let's say, a micron or below. Then the next idea was transport experiments. Also goes back to an early proposal here. So you have, let's say, your iron, and it's, you know, in this gas of cold atoms. And now you put on some electrical field, and that will, of course, accelerate the iron. And, you know, this is transport. But then there's another way of charge transport, and this is competing, if you want. And this is just the charge can hop, so you don't have to really move the iron, but just the, let's say, the electrons move, and in this way, you know, the electrons move from one atom to the next, and this is how the iron or the charge is transported. And you can see here, as a function of temperature, they predicted two regimes. For the higher temperatures, this mobility should be dominated by just the normal acceleration of the ion, whereas once you get to a cold enough temperature so that wave functions overlap, electron hopping should take over. And of course, that would also be interesting to see. Next, some kind of an obvious topic that we could investigate is use this iron for sensing. Yeah, so as you know, people build little quantum computers with ions and Paul traps, so you can very nicely access the quantum state and read it out of the ion. And we could do something here too. So, for example, you have the ion, you put it into some superposition state, move it into the BEC, and then measure locally the magnetic field that the BEC produces, or you can also investigate the, let's say, density fluctuations and things like this. Yeah. Now, in order to improve the sensitivity, there's ways where you can combine, yeah, this one ion that actually carries out the measurement with the second ion. And if you entangle the two ions, you can actually achieve that you're insensitive to some background noise and you're only sensitive to the things that the BEC do to your ion. And you, yeah. So this is about this transparency here. And the question was, if the electron is hopping from one, let's say, from one atom to the next ion, is that connected to molecular physics? And it is, of course, yeah. So, but in order to form a bound state, the energy would have to, the binding energy, you know, would have to be taken away. So that involves then some kind of collisional process with a third atom, which could happen, yeah. So that hasn't been really investigated yet, yeah. And then you can also go into the single atom regime, yeah, where you perhaps want to measure the electrical or the spin state of a single atom, yeah. Here, this is an idea where you have atoms in an optical lattice, one atom per lattice side, so this is called a Mott insulator, and with the ion, you have very good control of the position of the ion within nanometers. You can put it next to an atom and then see whether you can, you know, measure the state of the atom or entangle the ion with the atom. And it doesn't have to be only cold atom physics. You could also place the ion next to some surface and then measure, you know, the electrical fields, for example, that come from that surface. And some of that stuff already has been done. I think what is also very interesting is to measure, use this setup to measure decoherence and dissipation. So let's say you have your ion, you bring it into some superposition state, and you know, if it's not in the BEC, that superposition state has a certain lifetime before it decoheres. And now, you know, you could might just investigate what happens, how quickly is this superposition state decohering once you bring it into a BEC, and you might want to understand that. And then even more fancy and advanced proposals have occurred, so where you don't have just a single ion, but you have an array of ions, and these form, of course, a lattice, and then this lattice now immersed into this cold cloud of atoms, and the cold cloud of atoms, yeah, you can have phonons, and then you can have, you know, the phonons of the superfluid of the BEC coupled to the, you know, lattice of the ions and so on. So, and then, you know, you can simulate other Hamiltonians of interest. And then there's this thing about the non-thermal energy distribution of the ion. This one. Actually, I'm not an, this is not my paper here. Yeah, you would have to look it up. They had some, I don't remember right now. Yeah, which Hamiltonian this was. I'm sorry. So the final idea is, yeah, that you can also look at the kinetics and the thermodynamics of this ion, which is immersed in a cloud of atoms. And normally you would think, okay, I have an ion, let's say initially it has a temperature the order of a millikelvin after laser cooling or so, and put it now into this cold cloud of atoms, which can be much colder, nanokelvins or so. And so through elastic collisions, there should be some sympathetic cooling. Yeah? But we will see that at the same time there's heating. And this heating is due to the fact that the ion is trapped in a Paul trap. And these Paul traps, they have micromotion. It's a coherently driven motion. Normally, it has nothing to do with heat. But in a collision with these atoms, this energy of the micromotion can be released and can heat the ion. And now you will see that there's some heating and some cooling at the same time. And in the end, you get a distribution that looks non-Maxwell-Boltzmannian, yeah, as we will see. So just to summarize a little bit what I've said so far, for most of the experiments that we would like to do with this atom-ion system, with this hybrid system, is that we need low temperatures. Yeah, first of all, in order to observe these low energy phenomena, these low energy bound states, but also it would be very good to have these low temperatures in order to gain more control over the particle interactions. If we can get into the S-wave regime, for example, then it has been predicted that there are Feshbach resonances with which we can control the atom-ion interaction. And what is also very important, of course, for these proposals is that our ion stays long enough in the cold cloud of atoms, so the ion lifetime has to be long. And here we also have some issues, yeah, that chemical reactions can take place. This is what you have mentioned. And also unwanted spin flips can take place. I'm going to talk about this also in a moment. So essentially, I now gave you a little bit of an outline of a couple of ideas, and now we are going to concentrate in the following on these two topics, because these are the main challenges of the field right now, and I want to give you a little bit of a feeling how far we have gotten so far. So I start again with this picture of this ion here in a cloud of atoms, and start off kind of naive, you know, let's say after laser cooling. We have an ion of a millikelvin temperature, and now we put it into this cold cloud of atoms. They elastically collide, and you would think that within, let's say, a few collisions or so, there will be thermalization and sympathetic cooling, and then the dynamics will die down. You're in some equilibrium. Is that right? Well, it is right, yes and no. Yeah. So what I first want to show you, yes, we can cool an ion that is has enough energy, or has lots of energy, we can easily cool it down with our cold atom cloud. And so this is one experiment that we can do, and there's also related experiments, by the way, in Rangwala's group here in Bangalore. So you can start out, for example, by displacing the ion in this harmonic ion trap, so then it gets some high potential energy that can be on the order of hundreds of Kelvin or thousands of Kelvin, and then you just release it, and then it oscillates back and forth in this ion trap, and as it goes through the cold atom cloud, it will be colliding with the cold atoms, and this leads to some cooling. And then, you know, we just measure how long does it take before the ion kind of sits in the center of this cold atom cloud. And these are now a couple of measurements that we did for different initial potential energies or ion energies. So here in green, the initial energy was 1,000 Kelvin. Here in this color here, this was 300. Then in orange, this was 100 Kelvin. And in red, this is 1 Kelvin. And so what do we see here? This is the time that we allow this ion to oscillate in this trap after we've given it its energy. And then we measure what is the probability that we find the ion in the center of this atomic cloud. And you can see here that this probability, of course, increases. Yeah. For 1,000 Kelvin, it takes, you know, several seconds before there is a good probability to find the ion. Now, when the ion only has 300 Kelvin, you can see that this goes much faster. Yeah, with about a second or so, it will be in the center. If it's at 100 Kelvin, you know, it's a fraction of a second. And then, if it has a Kelvin or so, it actually, you know, within a few milliseconds, yeah, it will be cooled down. So that seems to work quite nicely. And it's kind of convincing. Question is now, now it's in the center, it's cold, but how cold is it really? And is it as cold as the temperature, as the cold atoms? And that's not the case. What you find is that the temperature at first is determined by the micromotion. And so what is the micromotion? Well, you have this Paul trap. Here you have some of these electrodes. And the Paul trap works with radio frequency. And there's one location, and radio frequency means that there's electrical fields that jiggle back and forth, and they normally also accelerate and decelerate the ion very quickly. So as it moves in the harmonic potential, with its secular motion, then on top it has this micro motion. And so you don't really want that micro motion. And so there's one, typically or ideally, there's one location in such an ion trap where the electrical fields actually zero out. And that's where you want to trap your ion. But if you have some electrical offset fields, they can push the ion a little bit to the side, and then it's trapped at the location where it jiggles very quickly back and forth. So it has this micro motion. And this micro motion can then be released in a collision with atoms. And so this is kind of how this looks like. You have this ion, it collides with atoms, and these atoms are now confined in a very shallow dipole trap with a depth of about 10 microkelvin or so. And the micromotion is typically orders of magnitude larger. And so it can, you know, in a collision, it can be released and it kicks out these atoms. Now, at the same time as it kicks out the atoms, of course, also the ion is heated. And this leads to heating of the iron. Now we can easily see this process just by looking at the atom number in our trap, in our atom trap. The iron is always trapped, but the atoms get kicked out. So initially you start out here with 10 to the 4 atoms. And then if you have a strong electrical offset field, let's say, so this means high micro motion, you lose the atoms quicker as compared to when you have a relatively well compensated micro motion. And we can use this to compensate this micro motion. Yeah. So here you see, this is atom loss after a certain interaction time. And you see how the atom loss goes down from 30,000 atoms to 10,000. Yeah. If you just choose the right electrical field. Yeah? And so here we have now a nice tool, yeah, to compensate this micro motion energy, and we should get down to energies corresponding to about 1 microKelvin. So that's very cold. Still, if we do experiments and we make a measurement, we estimate how much micro motion we have, we still see that we have on the order of a couple hundred microKelvin left, and that means that there's other sources of micro motion that we have to compensate, and one is, for example, phase micromotion, but I don't want to go into this right now. So now I want to tell you a little bit about this non-thermal energy distribution of the iron. When the iron collides with the atoms, it gains energy, but also sympathetically cooled at the same time. And what we find is that the iron energy has kind of a long energy tail towards high energies. How does that come about? And the thing is that, you know, right at the ideal point where the micro motion is zero, the micro motion cannot set free a lot of energy. But in a collision, the iron can actually be kicked out. You know, there's some energy release, can be kicked out to a spot further out here. And there, the micromotion energy is much larger. And so the next collision out here, more energy can be released, and that can bring out the iron even further. And so very quickly, you can have some kind of an avalanche of energies that are being released as the iron moves out. Yeah, and this gives you kind of like Levy flights, if you want, towards outer regions where it takes some time for the iron then to be cooled back into the center. And this also leads to a non-thermal distribution of this iron energy. So this is an animation, yeah, where you see that it kind of, the iron scattered by the atoms back and forth and can get some energy. So here's a numerical calculation of this iron energy. You start out with, let's say, 10 Kelvin, and initially this energy is quickly cooled down to a certain level, and then more or less, you know, it stays at that level, and there are some excursions here. Now this level that it gets cooled to depends on the micro motion that the iron has at its stationary point. If this micro motion corresponds to a very small energy, then also the thermal kinetic energy of the iron will be of that level. And if it's higher, it will correspondingly move up. Well, one way of probing the energy of ions was just the plot that I showed you before. It's not very precise. We have to calibrate it, but we can see how quickly the iron kicks out atoms. Yeah. So if it's very cold, it takes much longer to kick out atoms. So these are calculations. Yeah. And these are not measurements. Yeah. And so if you now do calculations like this, and then you can do some statistics and see what the iron energy distribution is. And so here you have the kinetic energy of the iron. And then this is the probability density And then you get distributions like this. So this would be the blue one, would be the distribution for an ion that has at the center a micro motion of about 1 millikelvin. And you can compare this now to a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution of a particle with the same kind of temperature. And then you can see that the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution here on the high energy side, you know, drops down much more quickly. So the effect of the micro motion of the system, yeah, the driven system, is really that the ion has this much larger high energy tail. If the micro motion of the ion was not 1 millikelvin, but let's say 17 millikelvin, you get a similar distribution as the blue one. It's just shifted to the right. Yeah. So, okay. So then you could say, okay, we just, you know, go to essentially zero micro motion and then, you know, and we're done. And one aspect that I also want to mention is that this energy distribution of the ion critically depends on the mass ratio of the neutral atoms, the coolant, and the ion. And the thing is, the smaller the neutral atom mass is, the better that cooling works. The higher the neutral atom mass is, the more this non-thermal distribution will prevail. And why is that? Because you can imagine if the atoms were, let's say, infinitely large, heavy, yeah, so then in a collision with an atom, actually, you know, in a collision with an ion, they cannot take up any kinetic energy, but it's much more like a pinball game where the ion that has a certain micro motion now sets free that micro motion, and that micro motion gets completely converted into kinetic energy of the ion. And so whenever an ion hits an atom, it basically gets accelerated out. And so this effect is worse the heavier the atom mass is. And you can see here is that if the atom mass is twice of the ion mass, then you see you get this really strong tail here. Now, in our system of rubidium and barium, rubidium is lighter than barium. We are here at a mass ratio of about 1/2, and then we are not too far away from the thermal Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Yeah, yeah. This is what happens if you have a system where the ion wouldn't be driven, but actually here it's because the ion is driven. It's slightly different. Yeah. So even if the masses are equal, yeah, you have a strong non-thermal distribution. So finally, then the question is, how cold can we really get if we now take this micro motion and we, let's say, completely would compensate it? So at that point, you know, the ion would here sit at the center of the ion trap where there's no micro motion, but then there's this paper by Cetina et al. who investigated the system. And so what happens is that an atom that comes by attracts, of course, this ion. It pulls it out a little bit out of this ideal center. And so at the point where the collision will take place, this ion gets micro motion. So then effectively it has micro motion again. And so if they put in their numbers for our ion and atom system, we would get a final energy of about 100 microkelvin. Now you can do better with slightly different atoms and ion mass ratios, but it will be on the order of a microkelvin. So you can see that we are already close to this temperature, and would be nice in the near future to see a little bit whether we can really reach this limit or perhaps even get below this limit. So you see that reaching low temperature is a difficult issue in these kind of experiments. It's a challenge that every group is still working on. And then there's the second point, which is about, you know, the stability and lifetime of the iron. Yeah, you want to carry out an experiment with this iron, and if it immediately is gone, yeah, then you cannot carry out that experiment. So these losses can be due to chemical reactions and spin flips. Two possibilities. So I want to quickly talk a little bit about reactions, what can take place. First of all, perhaps, how can we detect whether a reaction has taken place? Yeah. So here you have a picture of two ions, two barium ions. They form a little crystal. So when we, put a laser beam on them, they fluoresce and we can see their presence by the two points. Now, if one of the ions all of a sudden turns dark, then this is an indication that something must have happened and a chemical reaction might have happened. You see that the ion is actually still there because it takes up the place. If it had gone, then this ion here that still radiates would have moved into the center of the trap. Another way to see whether a reaction has taken place is the sudden release of energy. For example, a reaction takes place, so much energy is released that it kicks the ion out of the center of the trap. The ion is still trapped because these traps, ion traps, are very deep, on the order of a few electron volts or so, but it now orbits out here and doesn't interact with the atoms anymore. And so we see that in terms of that the atom number is not decreasing. Yeah, we see that the atom loss is basically zero. And there are a number of reactions that we have already observed. Yeah, perhaps one of the first and trivial reactions is something that we call charge exchange. You have the rubidium atom, you have the barium ion, and then in a collision, the charge can just simply hop over if this is energetically allowed, and you find then typically rate cross sections or rate constants of that order. So that means that the ion lifetime is, if you have work with the density of your atoms of 10 to the 14, is on the order of 100 milliseconds or so. So that's actually a relatively good lifespan for such experiments. But what we find is that there's other reactions that are much more severely limiting us, and these are three-body recombinations. So if you have now this ion and it collides with two atoms, then a molecule can form, and the third atom takes away some of that energy. And typically, you would normally say, such a reaction, it involves several, three particles, and so it should be suppressed, yeah, because this is less likely to occur. But because our densities of 10 to the 14 are already high compared to the cross section that we have, because the cross section is relatively large, these reactions can happen quite often, yeah. And so if you put in now the densities of 10 to the 14 per cubic centimeter, the ion lifetime is all of a sudden only 100 microseconds, yeah. So this is a factor of 1,000 faster. So essentially, once you put in the ion into the atom cloud, this reaction already takes place and eats up your ion. So you really have to think about what to do with this. And I'm almost finished. One other thing is spin relaxation. Here there have been some experiments by the group of Michael Kühl in Bonn, where you look at, you have spins of the ion and you prepare a spin of the atomic cloud, and then you see how quickly do these spins flip. And normally this is nothing bad, one guy flips up, the other one flips down, you have a conservation of spin. But what is the problem if you have these collisions that are based on spin orbit coupling? So here, even though you have, let's say, two spins and they're in a spin stretch state, one can flip its spin and the angular momentum, of course, has to be conserved, but that angular momentum can go into the relative orbital angular momentum of the two atoms. And in that way, you see a quick depolarization in your sample, and that would be a problem. And this is actually the case often with these heavy ions that you deal with. Now, we have some ideas how to cope with these problems. Yeah, you can either you make a good choice of atoms and ions, or you can kind of prevent actively these molecule reactions to happen. For example, here is just a brief idea. We have the barium ion, and it collides with the rubidium atom, and we want to use Rydberg states in order to prevent this collision really from happening. Yeah, what happens is we have some additional light, and once the atom gets close to a certain distance of the ion, the light will excite this rubidium atom into a Rydberg state, and this Rydberg state will be strongly repelled by the positive charge of the barium, and so it will be kind of like deflected by this wall that will appear here, this potential energy wall. And as it's reflected, it will be de-excited again in an adiabatic way to its original ground state. And in this way, we can shelve this ion from getting very close to the rubidium atoms, and then molecule formation can be suppressed perhaps. So this is something that we currently work on. With this, I just want to summarize. I talked about this hybrid atom ion system, which would be interesting toy system to study open quantum phenomena. Talked about formation of polarons, transport, using the ion for sensing, investigating dissipation and decoherence. And in the end, I talked a lot about these non-thermal energy distributions of this ion in this cloud. We have a good number of challenges to cope with. First one is how to get cold, and then how to suppress chemical reactions and spin flips. With this, thank you very much for your attention. Can you repeat your question?
The two-body interaction that is just you told here. Okay.
This here?
No. This two-body interaction. Okay. Just earlier you go, earlier slides.
These directions here. I'm sorry, I don't.
Earlier slides, before the slide, not these slides. Previous slides. Can we go?
Okay.
Oh, this.
Yeah.
Have you visualized this or just been annotated this?
So here are some papers we have studied these reactions. Yeah.
Have you visualized?
So a question here in the back.
Yeah.
Just a detailed question, but a lot of the trapped ion talks I've gone to say that you can kind of neglect this micro motion within the traps, but in your experiment, it seems to be important in terms of the minimum temperature you can achieve. Is it because the trap's different, or is there something else going on that's important?
Okay. What do you mean something else is going on?
I've heard a lot of trapped ion talks just neglect all the micro motion. They say that you do not have to worry about the micro motion. You just sort of average out over this degree of freedom. But in your experiment, it seems to limit the minimum temperature. So I'm just wondering why it's important in your experiment and why others say it's not important in their experiments.
So in experiments where you deal with ions and cold atoms, I think it will always be relevant. If you have an experiment where, we have a string of ions, yeah, and they, move all, synchronous with the micro motion, so then the micro motion drops out, yeah. So in these quantum computer ion trap experiments, it's not so much of an issue then, yeah. But here, since the neutral atoms have a different reference frame, if you want, compared to the ions, it does make a difference. And I think it will always be problematic, for all of these experiments. So theorists often like to, you know, downplay it a little bit if they have written a paper where they have ignored this. Yeah, I think it's a serious issue.
Okay, thank you. And then maybe a follow-up question, if I may. Early on in the talk, you showed a proposal paper that discussed mobility with electron hopping from ion to ion, and the numbers were phenomenal, 10 to the 8 centimeters squared per volt second. But is there any idea how you would measure that?
Let's go to that slide. So in principle, you can think of something if you now have the let's say some ion detector on some end, yeah, and you have your atomic cloud, which is kind of large enough, yeah, that there's a certain distance that this ion has to bridge until it hits the detector, and then you can just release the ion at a well-defined time and measure the time until it will take before it hits the detector. So that would be a time of flight measurement.
Hello. So you were talking about the ion superposition state. Hi. So you were talking about ion superposition state interacting with the BEC. So is there any prediction on that? Because now the induced dipole will now be shared by N atoms, because BEC is N atom state. So now will the decoherence be faster or?
So is it this year or this kind of experiment?
Yeah, ion inside a BEC. So BEC is N body quantum state.
Yeah.
So now if the ion induces a dipole now, it'll be shared by N atoms?
Okay, so I think there's a lot of questions that you could ask. Yeah, what I was just was thinking about is you put the ion in there. The BEC typically, you know, these are atoms that have a certain spin, and so they produce a magnetic field, and you could see whether you can measure that magnetic field. But there might be, and there have been proposals who have estimated that this should be actually possible, yeah, but there might be other things that you have to look into, because, you know, there are also collisions that will take place. There can be and these collisions also, the spins can flip and so on. So these are things that would have to be taken into account, yeah, and that plays a role for this decoherence, I think.
So maybe this is a chance to ask a question I've often wondered about from and get an answer from an expert. I've often wondered, why isn't it that in this situation that the rubidium atoms, which must have a sort of linear polarizability, sort of get attracted to the ion, kind of clump around it, and then reduce the micromotion by increasing the effective mass of the ion?
So I think this goes in the direction of this Polaron idea, actually. Yeah. So if the energy of this total system is small enough that such a bound state can form, yeah. So right now we are still in a regime where the ion is like a crazy warrior and it kicks out, you know, all the atoms that come close to it. But let's say you are able to cool or to bring down the micromotion such that this effect is not so dominant anymore, and then this clumping should occur. Now, there is still some other problems that occur then. If the clumping is too much, then you will have the three-body recombination that very quickly will happen. Yeah, so you have to then again come up with a scheme to protect the ion from getting too close to the atoms. Otherwise, chemical reactions will take place. Yeah, so it's just a very open system in that sense. Yeah. Where lots of reaction pairs and things can happen.
It could happen at lower temperatures, and then it could be a bit like a phase transition when it does happen.
I haven't thought about this, whether it's a phase transition, but perhaps one could call it that, yeah. It would be a state of matter, yeah, that changes properties because the energy is low enough so that certain bound states can form. Yeah. can discuss it a bit later, I guess.